Good morning, everyone. And this is really a special day for me to get to sit and interview with my colleague and my longtime friend, Dr. Samuels. Yeah. We're like brothers from a different mom. We go back a long ways. And in my former life, I tried recruiting him into my practice, and I wasn't able to do that. But Dr. Samuels was able to recruit me here, and I'm very grateful for that. Together, we share a lot of common history in Philadelphia, and we'll probably tell some anecdotal stories. So the last couple of years have been tough with COVID, and now we're talking about a triple pandemic now with RSV and the flu and COVID. It's on everybody's mind still, and we may see a resurgence. Take us back to March of 2020, when COVID first hit our shores. And from a heart failure standpoint, which seems to be one of the biggest concerns about COVID, how did you go about setting up a program?
Well, you know, we had some experience in the past with other maladies that prepared us a little bit for this condition. You know, the flu epidemic set into motion some concerns about respiratory failure. And we had technologies back then that could help with the lungs, artificial lungs in the form of the ECMO. COVID brought a whole nother dimension, not only to respiratory, but as you mentioned, heart. But we had the technologies upgraded to systems that allowed us to deploy artificial hearts and artificial lungs in the form of ECMO. And it enabled us to build on that platform so that we could rescue patients who were literally dying of respiratory and or cardiac failure with this technology.
So for the people listening, ECMO, tell us what the ECMO stands for, and then describe for us, you know, as lay people, what does that mean?
Yeah. So ECMO is extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. And it's basically a form of the heart-lung machine that's miniaturized so that we can use it literally at the bedside, not just in the operating room. And we put in these plastic tubes in and out of the circulation. One of the tubes drains the blood out, it oxygenates it, and it pumps it back. And depending upon what the need is, whether it's respiratory or cardiac, we can control the entire circulation of the body and rescue patients in an attempt to recover them so we can discontinue that support after days or weeks on this technology. It's really very remarkable. It's been around for a few decades, but we've gotten very good at it. And here in the Einstein system, which is part of the bigger Jefferson network, we have some expertise that is pretty remarkable. Yeah. And we've saved quite a few patients at the time of the COVID epidemic. And even to date, we have a very robust program. And again, networking with Jefferson, we were able to save lives.
How do you know when a patient has a COVID lung problem or the flu that has gotten out of control? How do you know when you go from medications to mechanical support?
Yeah, well, you know, this is obviously a clinical diagnosis. They can't breathe. They're usually on a respirator and a ventilator. And despite our best efforts to manage them on the traditional therapies like the respirators and the ventilators, their lungs are whiting out on the x-ray. When we check their blood gases, their oxygen levels are extremely low. Their carbon dioxide levels are extremely high for the lung failure patients. And they're going to die unless we can advance ourselves up to some artificial form of respiration with the ECMO device. Similarly, on the cardiac side, we have the ability to take patients who are in shock. Mm-hmm. And COVID does that. This is one of the unique things about this virus, is that it not only causes the respiratory problems that a lot of people are familiar with, but we're learning more and more that it's causing pretty significant cardiac problems in the form of shock. And so we can rescue those patients as well with this technology, because it's literally bypassing the heart and the lungs, artificially speaking, and can restore stability to an otherwise unstable patient is going to die within minutes to hours.
Now, this technology has been around for a long time. It's much more evolved because of the crises that we've been facing. But you're a heart transplant surgeon, and there's a similar device, and maybe you can explain the difference between what a lot of people call the artificial heart, which is a ventricular assist device, or VAD, and ECMO. What is VAD, and tell us about your experience with that.
Well, I can talk for hours about this, Ray. It's something that I grew up with as a fellow, not knowing what this new technology at that time was. And this is back in the early to mid 90s. And I can recall, you want to hear an anecdotal story, I can recall going on the cardiac surgery service as a first year fellow, walking into the ICU at Hahnemann and looking at this machine, this big bulky machine clinking and clunking, and wondering, what the hell is that? And the chief resident said, go in the call room, there's a manual, and learn about it. It was a first generation ventricular assist device. So that's how it started back in the 90s. I was so fascinated with that technology that I embraced it and continue to embrace it. And fortunately, things have evolved. But the big difference between an ECMO and a VAD is that the VADs can serve several purposes. They can basically restore the circulation without an oxygenator, which simplifies things quite a bit. But VADs can stay in for a long time, and we can use them for many, many different purposes. One is to give the heart a rest and let it recover and take the VAD out, or transition it to a longer, more implantable VAD that can stay in the patients for months to years. And this is really the fun part, because now, 30 years later, we have these systems that are so successful that we're putting them in patients that are dying of heart failure that do not have transplant as an option. And we at Einstein are a center that puts these devices in non-transplant eligible patients. And they've been in patients for many, many years, allowing them to go back home, live normal, near normal lives. Some of them even go back to work. In fact, you know, over at Einstein main campus, there's a guy who parks the cars for the patients. He's on a VAD.
Wow.
It's the most incredible thing I've ever seen with the evolution of this technology. And to be there at the ground floor and to see where we've come from there to now, and who can imagine what the future will bring, is just so rewarding. Yeah. And so much fun.
So people refer to that as destination therapy.
Yes.
And one of the issues with heart transplantation is there are probably, 50 or 60,000 people in the United States on the list, but there's only about 3,000, 3,500 potential donors.
Yes. The reality is that we have too many heart failure patients who need a new heart, and we don't have enough hearts to deliver. And so this mechanical artificial heart has really solved and bridged that enormous gap. And in fact, you know, I sit on some advisory boards and panels. The future for this is even brighter with totally implantable systems, mm-hmm. where you would not even know the person has one walking around. And the technology is getting so good that there may come a day when we won't even need to be doing heart transplant at all. Depends on how things go, but the future is bright, and to be part of that is just so rewarding.
So suffice it to say, over the last 30 years, it's not a big clunky machine anymore.
Oh, no.
Well,
no,
what
no.
would you say the size of the VAD now is that you implant?
So now they're about the size of a D-cell battery. It fits well within the palm of your hand.
It's incredible.
It's just remarkable. You've seen this yourself in the course of your career, and I'm sure that, you know, you're as excited as anybody to see the evolution of this, because you know what, Ray, we might need one.
We might need one. Yeah. Well, you have to have a heart first. Some people say I don't have the heart. The interesting side now, Dr. Toluca, our partner, does most of that with you.
Yes, she is the director.
She's the director of mechanical support. Mm-hmm. What do you think in terms of people talking about xenografts, which is mm-hmm. implanting other animals' hearts?
Yeah. So, you know, there was a lot of interest in this decades ago. It never came to any realities and in any big sense. And then there was an interesting development a year ago down in Baltimore, Maryland area, where they put in a pig heart that was genetically engineered to be compatible with the human body. Because, you know, the problem really is rejection.
Sure.
That's true even when you transplant a human heart to a human. The problem is rejection. So imagine trying to transplant another species into a human. That immune barrier is just, you know, you would think it's completely insurmountable. But with the genetic engineering and technologies, that area has actually become pretty fertile, and the prospects are pretty good for hearts, livers, kidneys, solid organs. Mm-hmm. So we'll see how that goes. But right now, it's not quite ready for prime time. Mm-hmm. The mechanical technologies, the artificial hearts, are much better positioned, you know, for the foreseeable future.
Now, Jefferson Health has a robust transplant program.
Yes.
Not just in heart surgery, but also kidney, pancreas, liver, and what have you.
Yes.
And this is a collaborative team that it's really imperative that you have a collaborative team. And I'm sure even here at Einstein, you collaborate with them on a daily basis.
Yeah. You know, the whole enterprise, now that we're part of it, is just extraordinary. And yes, transplant, the VADs, the ECMOs, we're all part of a network that really amplifies what we do. We have so many more resources now. We're not just working in a silo. And so we collaborate with our colleagues downtown in main campus, our colleagues up at Abington. We have some experts in cardiology, heart failure, and cardiac surgery, heart failure. It's an incredible network and teamwork that we've built.
My understanding is also heart failure is still the number one diagnosis admitted to any hospital.
Yeah, it's enormous.
It's enormous.
And it's not diminishing. It's escalating. The healthcare expenditure, you know this better than me, but the healthcare expenditure for heart failure is probably number one on the list of costs for our society. So it's imperative on us to acknowledge that, to manage it, and to do the best we can to provide some semblance of a good life outside the hospital. That's what our goals are, is to get these patients out and these technologies and these teams of experts dealing with them enables us to do it.
So a patient comes to the hospital, sadly, if they have COVID or flu, RSV, it's pretty well established what the pathway will be. They'll be taken to the intensive care unit, collaborative intensive care team that will include pulmonologists, intensivists, cardiologists, cardiac surgeons, and then if need be, mechanical support is introduced. Similarly, if sadly someone comes to the cardiac catheterization lab with a heart attack and a large amount of muscle is lost, pretty clear we're going to be asked to place them on mechanical support. There are other devices. There's an Impella, which is another type of VAD, temporary ventricular assist device, ECMO. But how about the patient who's in the community, of which they're probably hundreds of thousands, who have chronic heart failure. And they might be in the community, and their medications, they're really limited. They have swelling of the legs, they're short of breath, and their quality of life is really diminished. How can they go about getting an opinion with a heart failure team, such as the collaborative team we have in Jefferson Health and or with you at Einstein? What would be the process?
Well, it's pretty easy. You just got to call or look up our number on the web. We have contact information all over the place, but probably the thing to do is to get on the web, look us up, and just click on the part for heart failure, and you'll find contact for any number of people and programs within our network. And once that happens, it's an amazing process to see how that's managed, because, you know, we have things at our disposal that some of the community places aren't even aware of, whether they're clinical trials, new medications, just a level of expertise that brings us up to a level that is necessary for that advanced stage of the disease. I mean, granted, you know, heart failure is a spectrum. So once you start advancing into the higher grades, you really it's really necessary to be in the hands of experts that know how to deal with it and have resources at their disposal that, you know, community places may not even be aware of.
Yeah. And to be clear.
Sorry, we have a question. You want me to ask or you have a thought?
I see the question, and we will ask it. This has to do with COVID. And before I get to that, one point I do want to make is that when we talk about coming to a collaborative heart failure team, such as Dr. Samuels described, we're not talking about taking away from your primary cardiologist. This is really an addition. It's an adjunct. So you might even end up on the heart failure list transplant or ventricular assist device, and you would come visit and see the collaborative team, but this doesn't take you away from your primary care physician or your primary care
cardiologist. That's a good point, because you're going to get back to your community. Yeah,
that's
our
the
goal,
whole point. Yeah.
Is to get back to your community, get back to your regular doctors, and we're here to provide that specialized service, but in no way are we altering the relationships that you have with your other doctors.
So it's complementary. So the question, and I think it is a great question, and it has to do with COVID, and it has to do with how it impacted us professionally, with our colleagues, with each other. Look, the whole world was, I'll say, we were scared. We didn't know what hit our shores, what was going to hit our shores. There were a lot of dark moments. I think we're both proud to say our team hung in there. I mean, it wasn't like we could stay home. So we're very proud of our team. And in fact, ironically, because of ECMO, cardiac surgeons were called around the country more than most specialties.
Yeah.
What kind of personal impact, and maybe you can tell some anecdotal stories.
Yeah, you know, I was talking to my family back in the heyday of COVID, and it reminded me a lot when AIDS hit the medical community. For us on the front lines with the nurses and everybody, it was a really scary thing because we were watching a malady, COVID, just killing people left and right, and we didn't have really good treatment for it. And then we were worried not only about our patients dying, but ourselves. And we were starting to see our own staff getting sick, our own colleagues getting sick. Some of them died.
Yeah, that's right. We had a resident
died. So I'll tell you, it was scary. It was really scary. I remember, you know, when I had to put these COVID patients on support.
Yeah.
You know, I was putting layers of personal protective equipment on, and I was still scared that somehow it was going to sneak through, or I was going to bring it home. I would take that stuff off, throw it away, take a scalding shower, and then go home and just like try to keep a distance, because I had no idea if I was going to get exposed or expose somebody to it. And it was nerve wracking.
Yeah, I just got a chill when you were telling that, because it brings back really haunting memories. So on the one hand, we're so proud of our colleagues, our nursing staff. You know, one of the images, sadly, was we would do this, but the families were not allowed to visit their loved ones, regardless of even if there were no hope. And we were standing there with our phones, you know, and FaceTiming families to their loved ones to say goodbye. It was that level of stress, anxiety. And you know, for us, I mean, if I may say,
north of 60,
we're seniors.
Yeah.
And it was believed and was accurately believed that we were at yet higher risk. And I know in my ICU here at Einstein Montgomery, I was clearly the most senior. I want to say the oldest, the most senior, the most experienced, the most senior physician in the ICU. And there were nurses much younger, and physician assistants and nurse practitioners and staff that were getting sick. And unsung hero, I want to mention, because I just nominated him. I better keep it a secret. I nominated him for an award. Our environmental services people you're talking about heroes on the front line, that every day came in as we were nervous going into the rooms to do procedures. They literally had to
clean it up
clean the rooms. And so many heroes and such stressful times, and lots of lessons learned that, God willing, if there's another outbreak like that, and maybe we're on the precipice of that, that we'll be better prepared and better understanding of what needs to be done.
Yeah, there, a lot of you know, it was and is still out there, but I think we really came together as a healthcare community. I mean, sure, everybody watched the news and they saw the stuff going on and everybody, but behind the scenes, there was a lot of dialogue and communication between competitive programs.
Yeah, even, absolutely.
You know, and a lot of times we forget that we're in this together.
Right.
Right. So you have in the Philadelphia market, the Delaware Valley, you have so many healthcare programs competing with one another. One of the things that I think we got out of this is we've got to band together. We've got to work together and solve this thing. And we did.
We did.
We really did. Yeah. And I'm very proud of that.
Yeah, and I agree. That's very well said. And a matter of fact, ironically, tonight is the Delaware Valley Society of Thoracic Surgeons meeting. And anybody who's seen the Facebook, well, I had to get in a shirt and tie for my friend and my chief. But also tonight is a very important dinner meeting. And guess what? The topic is basically telling, we don't like to say war stories, but sharing experiences over difficult times the last couple of years. Ironically, it happens to be tonight in the King of Prussia area that, and you will see there'll be 50, 60 heart surgeons from around Philadelphia, the suburbs, as far up as Lehigh, and as far down as Delaware and New Jersey. And that's very unique in the Philadelphia area. Mm-hmm. And it certainly has been enhanced since the pandemic and the stress that we've been in. And I am proud to be in the Philadelphia area and be part of the Jefferson Health program, but also to be friends and colleagues with across, whether it's Penn or Temple. Unfortunately not Hahnemann. So as we wrap this up, you know, Philadelphia has great history, and I would be remiss if not to talk about the heart history at the great institution known as Hahnemann, and maybe better than any other example, why we do need to come together and share resources, because we can never let anything like that happen again. Growing up, Hahnemann, Temple, Penn, Jefferson, Philadelphia General Hospital back in the day, and of course, Children's Hospital in St. Chris. You know, we're known nationally for our hospitals in Pennsylvania, and particularly in the Philadelphia northeastern part from Hershey, Lehigh, and around the area. But let's talk about Hahnemann for a second. We only have a couple minutes left because it's dear to both of our hearts, going back to Charles Bailey and all that. So talk a little about the history of heart surgery in Philadelphia.
Yeah, well, you know, I came...
As you remember it.
Yes.
Remember 1940?
No, okay. No, I came to Philadelphia from New York. I'm a New Yorker. My accent will come out if I keep this up. But I came to Hahnemann in the 80s for medical school, thinking I'll go back to New York. And then as I stayed on board there, I learned more and more about its history in the city and what the city was doing in terms of cardiac, the Lykoff Institute.
Sure.
The fame of Charlie Bailey, who did the first mitral valve repair, commissurotomy, made the cover of the Time magazine. As I learned more and more about it, I fell more and more in love with it, and stayed on board as a general surgery resident, then a cardiac surgery fellow, and was fortunate to be hired there when Hahnemann was in its heyday.
Yeah,
I mean, imagine a program now in this area that was doing close to 2,000 hearts a year when I was hired, and doing everything from transplant to these primitive devices we were just talking about, and looking into the future. The opportunities in the Philly area at Hahnemann in particular were just limitless, and I was lucky to be part of a artificial heart program at that time. And I've never regretted a single day where you and I are the generation where you were on call every night.
Yeah.
We still say that, right?
Right.
We still say that. We're on call every night, and we're happy. We would do it all over again. And here we are now, senior surgeons, mentoring the talents of our partners. And it's really been great. I think we got a little more gas in the tank, but it's really been great. And the Philly area has been so prolific.
Well, that is wonderful. Let's see. We
here's another question for Dr. Samuels. Symptoms people should be aware of. Wondering how does COVID, RSV, and flu impact people with heart conditions? So what should they be aware
of? It's pretty serious. Symptoms-wise, probably the most common is still going to be shortness of breath. I don't want you to panic, but you know, you've just got to be aware and vigilant. See your primary care. And if symptoms aren't going away, you know, get yourself looked at more thoroughly and closely, especially this time of the year with the triple, you know, virus threats going on. Do not allow yourself to wait too long to the point that, you know, therapies that you could have gotten sooner than later are now no longer going to work. But shortness of breath is probably, could be cardiac, could be respiratory. And it's such a common problem now. But again, don't panic, but just seek medical attention. And if it doesn't get better soon, then get looked at more carefully before things really start to spiral. Would you agree?
Yeah, one of the fallouts of the pandemic was that, as Dr. Samuel said, we were all scared, physicians, patients, and there were a lot of patients who just refused to come to the hospital because they were scared to get COVID. They might have been having chest pain, and they just, you know, figured they would just deal with it and not come. And sadly, there were lives lost by not coming to the hospital, or if they did come and they came late in the course of their heart attack or what have you, it was difficult to get them the kind of treatment we necessarily would want to. And so that's one of the lessons we learned is, as Dr. Samuels says, please see your primary care physician. I get a yearly exam. I just had my exam with Dr. Drum here in Norristown last week. See your cardiologist. I happen to follow with the CCP cardiology group here at Dr. Mercier. We have an excellent full-time team, obviously, at Jefferson and Einstein as well. The important thing is don't stop your care because of what's going on out there in the environment. And that is not only the pandemic, but we understand that these are difficult times economically and all kinds of stresses in the world, but you need to take care of yourself. You need to take care of yourself first before you can take care of anybody else. Another question we have is about tissue bowels having a mild leak. It's kind of off the subject a little, but I think it just wraps around the same concept is if you're having shortness of breath and you've had a valve replacement, it could be that, particularly in the case of the question was a biological valve. Biological valves don't necessarily last forever. So if you have a pig or cow valve and you're starting to feel that there are symptom changes, you need to talk to your doctor, get us what is known as an echocardiogram, and make sure the valve isn't leaking, or sometimes the valve can actually get blocked again. So we're pretty much at the end of the time, I believe, our 30 minutes. I don't know how to thank Dr. Samuels for so much. One thing we have in common we didn't mention about Hahnemann is the late great Dr. Stan Brockman.
Oh my goodness.
I was a resident for 2 years under Dr. Brockman when I was at Jefferson. And then he left with our colleagues, Dr. Goldman and Dr. Sutter, and they went to Hahnemann. That's where you picked up with Dr. Rohit Mars, who of course is the chief of Jefferson's Health Network Cardiac Surgery Program. That's a whole other show.
That's another show.
But Dr. Brockman was something special, wasn't he?
He was he loved a force. He was a force not to be reckoned with. He trained a lot of heart surgeons here in the city, us included. We owe a lot to him and his teaching methods. Relentless pursuit of perfection, attention to detail, take no prisoners. We tell these so-called war stories in the OR practically on every case because that's how what an impression he made on us. But I think to his credit, he trained some outstanding cardiac surgeons and
many who are still in the Philadelphia area.
Yes, and
in addition to yourself,
he was a Hahnemann Jefferson guy.
Yeah, well, you know. We love talking stories. We'll be talking shop later tonight, but When you think about Dr. Brockman, Dr. Hank Edmonds, Dr. Dick Eady, Frank Rosato, Herb Cohn, and Scott Goldman was basically my professor too.
Yeah.
And the list just really goes on and on.
Well, you know,
Dr. John Templeton.
Did you know that Dr. Morrison, I did his CABG surgery?
I did not know that.
Yeah. Well, I think that says something.
Did you harvest the vein from the leg? Because Dr. Brockman used to yell at me all the time when, you know, if you bumped his elbow by mistake, you heard about it.
Oh, for sure.
One time he started saying, "Dr. Singer, stand still. You're doing the cha-cha." Well, on that note, that image of Dr. Singer doing the cha-cha in the operating room, we want to thank everybody for tuning in. We're going to have to get Dr. Samuels back for a longer edition so we can tell some of those war stories.
That'll be fun. Thank you.
Thank you, too. That wraps up Ask Your Heart Surgeon with Dr. Ray Singer for today. Thanks again to Einstein Healthcare Network's Chief of Cardiac Surgery, Dr. Lewis Samuels, and Dr. Ray Singer, Chief of Cardiac Surgery at Einstein Medical Center, Montgomery. I'm Sharon Eisenhower. Have a great day.